If you want to turn in your Bibles, it's also will be on the screen, it's in your bulletin, to Galatians chapter 4. We're continuing with our series there, and it's going to be verses 1 through 7 in Galatians 4. I want to invite you just to pray with me briefly again one more time before we begin. Father, thank you for your word. We thank you that you have so much depth. We cannot exhaust the depth of the riches in your word, that we can come back time and time again, and there are new and fresh things. So give us fresh insights, not just to learn something new, but just to see more deeply the meaning of the gospel, that we are loved and glorified in Christ and adopted because of what you have done. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, one of Tim Keller's most helpful books, I think, he's written a number of them. One of the most helpful ones, though, is The Prodigal God. And he spends a long time in this book. It's essentially an in-depth, detailed walking through of the parable. We read some from it today, of the prodigal son, which many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with. But I think one of his really key and helpful insights in this, one of the kind of the major themes of it, in fact, is that he points out that both of the sons in this parable, there's an older son and a younger son, and both of them actually have the same wrong paradigm in how they relate to God. They're both working under the same mistake. And God, even though it looks different in how that plays out, and God reaches out to both of them with the same love and grace. So the parable, as a quick refresher, you've got these two sons, the older son, the younger son, and they're sons of a father, right? And the father represents God. And the younger son, he runs away, right? He asks for all of his inheritance right away. He runs off and he squanders the whole thing. He just blows it. And but then you have the older son, and he's very faithful. He's very responsible. He's very diligent. He follows all of the rules. He does everything his father expects him to. But then, you know, the younger son comes back, and after he repents and he comes back home, you catch a glimpse inside the heart of the older son, because his father comes out to him, and he starts begging him, entreating him to come in and celebrate, and the older son doesn't want anything to do with it. He's bitter, and he's angry, and he's resentful. And this is what he says. This is the older son. He says to his father, look. These many years I have served you. I've never disobeyed your command, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. Now, the key word in that response is served. I've served you these many years. And you see, this is actually the heart of all of our struggles with God, whether you are a Christian today or you're not a Christian, right? This is the same issue. It's the same issue for both of these sons, in fact. Both of them feel that the way that God expects them to relate to him is as a slave relates to his master, right? Meaning that there is work to be done. There are certain expectations here. There are certain expected outcomes, and you are going to toe the line and produce this work, and if you fall out of line, you fail to produce the expected results, you're getting hit. And so that's it. That's the whole relationship. And these requirements, these expectations do it. And so the younger son looks at this, he's thinking about this, and he says, I'm out of here. I don't want anything to do with that. That's the way this is going to work. I'm gone, right? I don't want to relate in this. I don't want to live inside that kind of relationship. And so he runs away. Or the older son, he looks at that and says, okay, I can live with that. I can do that. And here's, I can fulfill what's expected. I will follow these rules. I will do the right things. I will fulfill all of these expectations, and I will earn my reward in this system. Right? But both of them, the whole time, they have this mistake. It is a mistaken notion of how God wants us to relate to him. Right? Because really, what God wants, he wants us to relate to him as children relate to a father who loves them. That is what God is after. And this is the mistake that Paul is driving at. He is trying to correct with the Galatians. And I'm going to read this passage for us in Galatians 4, 1-7. I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. But he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. So here's the main point from that for the Galatians and for us. And it is to relate to God as a son. Relate to God as a son. And yes, that goes for those of you who are women today as well. I'll explain why. Right? Because part of the difficulty is you look at this passage, and there's others like it. If you go back into this passage and you tweak the translation here, and you instead of sons, you say sons and daughters, or you say children of God, it loses actually some of its meaning, right? Because it's operating in a context where only the sons inherit. The sons are the one that inherit everything from their father in this particular context. So it's in this context God is saying to all of us, men and women, you are to inherit everything that I have. You are to get all of what is mine, and I want you to come into, right? And so don't let the male pronouns here throw you, okay? So it's meant for all of us. Here's how I want to look at this passage this morning. I want to spend a little bit of time, we did some last week, but more time unpacking what does this mean that the law is our guardian, right? And that Jesus fulfilled the law. And then we're going to just move to really the chief application here, which is what does it look like? How do you move from a slave mentality to a son mentality? That's the movement, right, that God wants us to take. So let's start by just taking a look at verse 1 and 2. And it says that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything, but he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. So Paul is continuing this analogy. He started at the end of chapter 3. We talked some about this last week, right? Where this is a practice that was going on in ancient Greece, ancient Rome, and you had wealthy families entrusted their sons, they entrusted to the guardianship, to the education of this guardian, all right, this tutor, until the son arrived at the age of maturity, the age of inheritance. All right, and so this analogy that Paul's been using, it's a way of explaining what is the point of the law. And the point of the law is the same as the point of this guardian, right? It's there to educate. It's there to train. It's there to build you up into maturity until you get the inheritance of Jesus and of God. So the law is to help us grow and mature in this full appreciation of who God is, right? And his beauty and his goodness and his grace, and to love and respect God more and to see how much Jesus has done for us in fulfilling the law. Right? And so the law, it is there to help us learn who our Father is, God, and who Jesus as our Savior is. That's really what the law is doing. But it's interesting. I think even if you're at this place, right, let's say that you are a Jew thinking about the law before Jesus comes, or you're just somebody today, or you're looking at the Bible, and you're thinking about all these rules, all these laws, and you're looking at that. It still makes all the difference in the world whether you view those things as a son or a slave. Right? How are you thinking about these laws coming to you? Are they coming to you from a father who loves you, who's going to give you everything that he has? Or are these laws coming down to you as, you know, here's your terms of employment, right? Here's your contract of what you need to fulfill as part of this obligation. See, the laws are the same, right? The rules are entirely the same, and they're good rules, but all of the difference comes in how do you view this relationship? And what is the nature of the relationship that you have with God? How are you thinking about that? And that's why it says in verse 3 that we were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. It doesn't say unnecessary principles. It doesn't say oppressive principles. Right? They're just elementary. Right? They're meant to lead us to something more, which is the fulfillment, the fullness of being adopted as a child of God, being a son of God in his family through faith in Jesus, inheriting. That's what they're elementary to lead you to that. So let's go to how does Jesus fulfill this law? This is verse 4. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. All right, so here's one of the important questions here. Why does Paul use these descriptors of Jesus? Why does he zero in on these things, that he's born of a woman, he's born under the law? What is he trying to say by that? Well, really, if you want a fuller, in-depth explanation, I would recommend read all of Romans chapter 5. It gets into this more. Right? But in short, it's trying to say Jesus came in full humanity. He was fully human. He was born of a woman in order to fulfill our side of the bargain as humans. He's a human being, and he fulfills this law that we as human beings are continually falling short of. So Jesus is born, and he's born not just as a human being, it says, but he is born as a Jew. Right? He's born under this law. It means he's born under the full range, right, of all of these laws to the Jewish people, of the food restrictions and the ceremonies and the holy days and the purity laws and the Sabbath laws, all of it. Why? I think this is actually a really important thing for us in the church today. And I think that I say that because a lot of times people's view of Christianity, right, whether this is explicit or implicit, is, okay, you know, you have Old Testament God, and he's cranky and strict and vengeful, right? And isn't it so good that we live under New Testament God who's loving and gracious and forgives everybody? And as a result of that wrong approach and division, so many people, including so many Christians, just chuck the whole Old Testament. We don't need this anymore. We've got something better. Jesus has moved on. Jesus has surpassed this. He's wiped the slate clean. So we don't even need to look at this anymore. And not only is that wrong, but you're being deprived. You're missing so much of what God has to show us. You know, you look at Jesus throughout his ministry, and whenever he is talking about the law, Jesus has a very high respect for the law. He's always affirming the law is good. The law is perfect, right? And he says he came to fulfill, not to destroy the law. I'll give you just one. There's one standout, many, but one standout example of the respect that Jesus has for the law. All right, and this comes from Matthew 17, 24 to 27. And what happens is there's some tax collectors. They come up to Jesus and his disciples. They ask Peter, one of his disciples, they say, does your teacher pay the 2 drachma tax? Now, the 2 drachma tax was a flat tax. It was levied on all the Jewish people, the whole Jewish nation, in order to support the maintenance of the temple in Jerusalem. All right, that's what it was for. Now, Jesus is doing away with the temple. That's part of what he's there for. Part of his mission, part of his teaching is, I, Jesus, am the only temple you need. The temple is this point of access to God, right? You come to be near God. You come to get into his presence. And Jesus is saying, I'm it. Right? I'm all that you need. Right? And so that's why Jesus says in response to this to Peter, he says, Peter, you know, who do the kings of the earth take their toll or their tax from? They take it from their sons or from other people, right? And of course, they take it from other people. In other words, Jesus is saying he is the Son of God, right? And this temple is there as a way of worshiping and honoring God. And so here you have these tax collectors. They've just come up, and they are literally trying to tax God in order to pay and get money to try to worship God, right? It's absurd. Right? But you know, here's the really key thing that happens. Jesus goes ahead and he pays the tax anyway. Why? It's part of this absolute, holistic, unwavering support that Jesus has of the law. Right? Even down to this very indirect, very non-explicit, maybe misguided direction of the law, Jesus is still showing this unwavering support of the law. Jesus vindicates God's law. He says, Matthew 5:18, heaven and earth, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass away from the law until all is accomplished. Right, and so even the parts of the law that Jesus explicitly overturns, I mean, just says he's doing it, right? Like things like the food laws or laws about purity and cleanness. You never hear Jesus say something like, that was a bad law. That law, just didn't really get ironed out fully, didn't totally get smoothed out. Right? He never says that. Right? He's always saying, this was the point of that law. He's saying this, right, this is what that law, that practice was really meant to be about the whole time, from the beginning. Right? And so this is really valuable, I think, for us as Christians in order to gain more of the depths, right, the depths of the riches and wisdom that God wants for us to have. Right, in these parts of the Old Testament, even parts that seem completely removed from our life today, right, and shouldn't be taken in the wrong way, but they're there, they have an eternal purpose. Right, and so they're there to point us to some greater understanding of God's character or his goodness or his beauty. Right, so for example, you take these various purity laws, right, about Israel's food laws or their cleanness or uncleanness. Part of what God is trying to communicate is he is holy. And he wants his people to be holy and to be set apart. That principle doesn't change. And you have these civil laws, right, about trials and punishments and legal proceedings. And these things show us actually abiding principles of God's justice. Right, there's things that we can learn from this about how justice actually works. Right, in studying what are these principles behind this. Right, so that's kind of the value, right, of all of this law that Jesus is fulfilling. So let's move to the practical application. All right, and that's, what is the difference? What is the main difference in mentality between a slave mentality and a son mentality? I think one of the clearest and most consistent differences that will show up here is that if you have the mentality of a slave, there's going to be a real lack of either joy or peace in your life. It's not going to be there. And so that can be a starting point. That can be a telltale sign for you. You think about how you relate to God. How do you think, what is my attitude about God? What is my relationship with God? Right? Is there a joy and safety and eagerness in my relationship with God? Is there a sense of peace that I feel in his presence or not? I mean, that can be an indicator of how are you relating as a slave or as a son. As you think about it, you know, for a slave, even if you have a really good master, right? Even if you have a really kind master, always you can count on, he's always going to take care of you, always going to look out for your best interests, you're still a slave. And what that means is that there is a certain tenuousness, right? There is a certain uncertainty that will always be there of, well, yeah, things have been good so far, right? It's been all right up till now, but who knows? Right? Who knows how God's going to feel about me tomorrow? And he might just say, well, you know, that's it. It's been a good run, but you can go on your way now, and I don't really need you. Right, so because if this is your relationship, no matter what the perks are in that, it is ultimately one that is based on utility. And what that means is that I need to show, I need to prove that I am useful to God all the time, right? In order to make sure that God still wants to keep me around. Right, and there's never going to be any joy, any real joy in that kind of relationship. Again, I mean, you think about it, you could have the best boss in the whole world, right? You love this person, and they do really well, and they take care of you well. But as long as that is the fundamental way, the fundamental lens of your relationship, it still means that every day you are going to wake up and think, I got to earn it. I got to prove it. I've got to show I can still add value to this organization. And that's a burden that's always going to be on you. Because a slave, if he's wise, a slave never forgets that he is a slave. There's a moment you get too comfortable, the moment you get too presumptuous, that's when you find yourself out on the street. And so that mentality will always press on you. I think one of the best examples or illustrations of this is in the world of professional sports. Right? I mean, this is a world that is radically, radically based on the what have you done for me lately attitude. Right? And not just, you know, every year to year, but every game, every practice, every day. I mean, you could be one of the best athletes in the world. You could be some, you know, future Hall of Famer, but you know, the moment you get injured, the moment your game starts to slip a little bit, you lose your edge. Well, it's been nice, you know, he's had a good run, and let's look toward the future. Right? And that is so often how we think about our relationship with God. It is a slave mentality that I have got to get up tomorrow and prove it. And not only that, right, but there is an awareness, there is this gnawing awareness inside a slave mentality that even on your best days, you're still really not hacking it. Right? You're still really falling short. And so there's this uneasiness, right? And this is actually Martin Luther talks about this. This was part of his struggle, you know, before God's grace really got a hold of him. I mean, he knew all kinds of stuff about God. He knew a ton about God, and he was miserable, absolutely miserable. This is, he says, quote, "I did not love. Yes, I hated. I hated the righteous God who punished sinners." And Luther, as he talks about some of his Christian life, he talks about experiencing cold sweats, nausea, constipation, crushing headaches, ringing in his ears, depression, anxiety, and the feeling that there is an angel of Satan beating on him. That is not a son relating to his father. That is the attitude of a slave with a master who he knows he's never going to be good enough. So what does it look like? Or what does it look like to have the mentality of a son? Because that's what you are if you are a Christian. God says that you are adopted. He has adopted us as sons. That Jesus has redeemed us from the law so that we would be adopted into this new family. What does it mean to be adopted? Well, obviously, this happens today. Roman nobility did this as well. They would often adopt heirs outside the family. And they would bring this person in, and he would inherit everything that they had. All right. So you know what happens when you are adopted? Or you get a new family, you get a new name, you get new rights, you get a new structure, a new mode of living, and most importantly of all, you get the love, right? The unconditional love of your new parents, right? And you start receiving all of these rights and privileges and honors, and again, mostly the love. That is what God has done for us in Jesus. Romans 8 uses some of the same language here. I'm going to quote Romans 8:15. It says, "You did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear." You notice here again that there's this fear versus security. This is a big way that the difference in mentality actually plays out. Fear, security. But you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. And then it goes on to say a few verses later that we're also waiting eagerly for adoption as sons. So how are both of those true? Well, it goes on to explain we are waiting for the adoption and the redemption of our bodies. Right? So we have this full adoption in our spirit and in our heart, but we have these bodies that are corruptible, these desires that are still corruptible, and we are waiting, right, for the time in the new world, in the new heavens, where we will have the bodies, adopted bodies, that same as Jesus, right, that are immortal, eternal, and without sin. But what I want you to notice, both of these places, both Galatians and in Romans, he says that our adoption comes through the Spirit. This is verse 6 in our passage. It says, "Because you're sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son." All right, so this is what it means to be a son. You have the Spirit of Jesus. You have the same level of access and intimacy and love of God that Jesus did. That's what it means, that you are adopted to be a child in this family. Jesus is our elder brother in this family. It's what it says, Hebrews 2:11. He says, Jesus, that he is not ashamed to call us brothers. It's an incredible thing. And then when Jesus redeemed us to be adopted, we get Jesus' Spirit. Right, we get in Jesus the same spirit of relating to God that Jesus has. And so Paul underlines the significance of this, the practical significance of this, both Galatians 4 and Romans 8. He says, in both places, he says, the Spirit in our hearts cries, Abba. Right, and daddy is not an exact translation of Abba, but it's an approximation. Because what God is getting at is he's inviting us into this kind of familiarity, right? This kind of intimacy with God. right? That we can call out to God anytime, anywhere, about anything, and we can have confidence that he hears us as a father who loves us. And so this is a big part. This is a big part of what it means to have a son mentality. That there comes a security and a boldness of how you can approach God that few other relationships on this earth ever get even close to. And whether you feel that today about yourself, whether you personally would feel that degree of God being for you, of God's love for you, you have that. That's real. You have that same level of access, that same ability to approach and receive God's love. And really, that is one of the main goals of the Holy Spirit in your life. That is one of the main jobs of the Holy Spirit, is to testify to you that you have this. You have this security and love and intimacy from God as your Father. The Holy Spirit wants to give you assurance of that. This is what verse 7 is getting at. This is what I'm going to close with. It says, "You are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir." Well, an heir of what? Oh, an heir of all kinds of things. Right? You should, as a Christian, you should start developing a sense of fourness about your life as you go through your life. Right? That everything that happens in and around your life is for you. But God really, what he ultimately wants to lead us into inheriting is the best thing in the world, which is God himself. Right? That is what God wants to bring us to, that we have this complete and intimate and continually expanding relationship with the best person in the world. And really, that is the biggest change. That is the biggest change that comes from moving from a slave mentality to a son mentality. Because that desire, that's not even on the radar of someone who's a slave. That's not, maybe not even something that you would want, right? But God gives us, right, this personal, and this is what you grow in as a son, right, this personal claim that you have on God, right, and that God promises you not merely to treat you fairly and to give you good gifts, but to give you all of himself personally. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for these promises of who you are and who you promise to be for us. It is so hard for us to believe just how much of yourself that you want to give, all of yourself to us, while we feel so undeserving. And help us to reconcile this, not because we deserve it, but because you've made the way. You have come through and offered yourself to us in Jesus. And so that we would know and be able to live in the assurance of that relationship. And we ask that you would be doing that work of your Spirit in our lives. That your Spirit would be testifying every day more and more to each of us, to be overcoming doubts and overcoming fears of enabling us to see, yes, we are your children. That's never going to change. And that we are secure in your hands. We pray that you'd be doing that work in us to make us both humble and bold. In Jesus' name, amen.